Spencer Matthews.
What's going on, mate?
Welcome to Shoreditch, the ghetto of London compared to where you live.
Come on, Shoreditch is cool. Everyone knows it.
You used to hang out here, right?
My wife lived not far from here.
Okay.
I actually can't remember the name of the road she lived on, but it was in this general vicinity.
Yeah, so she lived in Shoreditch or?
Just past Shoreditch.
Yeah, okay.
Up past Shoreditch House on the right.
Okay.
Yeah.
Brick Lane. Maybe
type thing.
Yeah,
she thought she was extremely cool at the time.
Really?
Yes.
Now she's.
And what's your excuse?
Dude, I don't know. I've been around here so long that I've like I know all the crackheads by name. Like,
perfect.
Yeah, yeah. Good friends with some of them.
Well, that must be handy.
They're all members at Shoreditch House. I'm just kidding. So Clean Liquor is your big company.
Yeah, we've rebranded to Clean Co. Clean Co.
Okay.
So, yeah. So, and we'll have the word liquor, I'm sure, on some of the spirits when we launch in the US. But yeah, Clean Co is the business. Yeah. We essentially make incredibly low alcohol variants of spirits.
Okay. Yeah.
So, you know, so you can enjoy a G&T, a rum and coke, a mojito, a daiquiri, whatever you want.
Did you bring any today?
I didn't.
What?
I have come straight from the office as well, so that is irritating. If you drop. I'll get some scent. Okay. So you got some tomorrow. I should have.
We could have got like slightly hammered.
Well, thinking about it, I really should have. But no, I didn't bring any today. But no, it's an exciting time. It's cool. Obviously, I changed my relationship with alcohol about 2.5 years ago now. Mm-hmm. I used to drink a lot, like, you know,
I've heard.
Pretty regularly and quite often to excess.
Like once a week?
Yeah, yeah. On a good week. I try and be careful with the way I say it because I don't want to kind of I don't want it to seem like I was just kind of hammered all the time. Do you know what I mean? It was just as part of working in the city and being a kind of Londoner, I'd have a few beers after work or you know, I'd always have a glass of wine with dinner.
Yeah,
like I'd very rarely go to bed like wrecked.
Yeah,
but I was kind of always slightly under the influence of booze.
Yeah.
And I just found that it kind of really got in the way of just general life.
Making decisions.
Yeah, making decisions, you know, running a business. Yeah. Your creativity is pretty impaired. I think being a good father might have been quite difficult in the later years.
Yeah.
Obviously, when you're young, you can handle it. You know, back in the early days of my TV career, if you want to call it that.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, you can drink all day long, all night long, not really a problem. But I think as you begin to rust with age, the alcohol doesn't really help.
So it sounds similar to what I do because my companies are based on my lifestyle.
Yeah.
So the idea is usually born from what I'm doing anyway.
Yes.
And then trying to like make that a little bit better. One of my questions was, what was the reasoning behind it? And it's, I guess it sounds like you're trying to make money out of your hobby and then but also reduce your alcohol intake, so it's literally the perfect company.
Yeah, no, well that is pretty much it. Yeah, you know, it was replacing a kind of it's creating what was essentially a void in the market.
Yeah.
So when I did go sober, you know, I didn't want my social life to suffer.
Yeah.
So, you know, you'd still go out and you'd still have fun, in inverted commas, and you'd be in pubs and bars and restaurants as you would ordinarily.
Yeah.
But for making what's actually quite a positive life decision, you feel kind of punished because you're out and you can't enjoy yourself the same way that others do when drinking alcohol. And so you'll have an alcohol-free beer or a water or a Diet Coke and you kind of feel like...
it's weird.
You feel not only left out, but you also feel odd. You know, you've kind of got the finger pointed at you, especially if you're a woman, for example. You know, everyone just assumes you're pregnant, or it can't possibly be because you're busy. You know, or you've got something on the next day, or you're just trying to be better. For me, it was kind of trying to deliver that experience of drinking alcohol without changing your behavior. So, you know, you can have what is apparently an alcoholic beverage that's been mixed by a barman that feels exactly the same as your mate's gin and tonic, that tastes the same, smells the same, but that doesn't have any alcohol in it.
So literally none, or I think it was like it was like 1.2%.
It's 1.2%, which means that essentially you would need 47 double clean gin and tonics to have the same units of alcohol as a pint of beer. So it's essentially, there's less alcohol than a banana. It depends obviously how you use it. If you're just going to neck bottle after bottle of straight clean gin, you will feel the effects of the alcohol on your sixth bottle, for example. So, you know, you can legally drink it and drive.
Really?
Yeah.
Can you actually drink it as you're driving?
I suspect if you're allowed to drink water when you drive, then you probably can drink clean gin. Yeah.
Maybe we can test it. We'll just go around drinking out of the bottle.
We'll take your Lambo for a spin.
Drink driving in it.
Yeah. I mean, you know, the rules on this are still slightly muddied. I'm really not sure how the response would be if you did drink and drive. However, I know that you would legally be under the limit.
Okay. That makes sense. So, my first thought is I was a vegan for like 18 months it's probably about a month. It just felt like a lot longer. long story. But so I tried that for a while. When I saw Clean Liquor, Clean Liquor, Clean Co.
Yeah.
Is that because your brand's stretching across multiple things?
Yeah. So essentially we felt that the Clean Liquor Company, although obviously it does more of what it says on the tin, is limiting to liquor.
Yeah.
You know, if we ever did want to do wine, champagne, beer, you know, we'd then have to rebrand for those products down the line. And as we do have big ambitious dreams, we definitely will expand into all sorts of other no and low alcohol categories. So we felt, and it's also, you know, if you social network, Facebook, cleaner,
it's perfect. It's like Clean Co. Then you can literally brand stretch it and it's obvious straight away.
Yeah.
No, it's good. It's a good decision, I think.
Thank you.
So my first thought was it's like the vegan, like, you know, compared to meat, like in a way, but it's like in the same environment, as in it's in clubs, it's in bars, it's in, you know, wherever, like just like food, it's everywhere.
I suppose if you're comparing it to food, it would be kind of like the beyond meat or the you know, that's where we're aiming to get to the direct replacement, I suppose, instead of the suitable alternative. We want to be the credible replacement. So back in the day, if you decided you wanted to be a vegan, you know, a Sunday roast might look like a nut roast. Then came corn. Then came a vegetarian option.
Yeah.
You know, and then came honest. You know, beyond burger. Meat and honest burger and impossible burger and all that stuff that now is incredible. And you know, now if I was given an impossible burger, I may not even realize that, you know, it was an impossible burger. So
I used to trick my friend Crazy Steve. I used to get a...
Why is Steve crazy?
Well, he used to be called Psycho Steve.
Right.
And then he got brain damage.
Thought he'd be nicer then.
And then he calmed down a little bit. Okay. So now we just call him Crazy Steve. It's a long story. But crazy, he's been my best mate since I was a kid.
Okay.
I used to trick him when I was vegan. I'd give him like a fake chicken pie. And I'd be like, and he'll just eat it because Steve, he's on a different level of like, he needs food all the time. He's like running around. And then he'd eat it. And I'd be like, was that meat in that, you reckon? And he'd be like, no. And I'd be like, yeah, it was actually. And he could never tell the difference. So I used to be like, oh, we're at that level now.
Yeah.
My question is, why would you drink normal gin over your gin? Logically, it makes no sense because you're just going to get hammered. And if you want to keep drinking and enjoy the drink, you might as well drink the one that you make.
That's kind of my thought process. Obviously, I understand kind of alcohol's place in society and the history that it has with people and how
people... Okay, what is that?
Well,
hammered.
Everyone associates drinking alcohol with having fun, right? Like everyone associates having a drink with relaxing. Everyone associates, or by relaxing, I mean like taking the edge off your day. That's everyone's favorite excuse for a drink is I've had a big day.
Yeah.
You know, alcohol... It's not going to take the edge off anything. It's going to really upset your system. And you know, if you have too much of it, it's going to make for a really tough day with two children. I'll tell you that.
Yeah.
But I wouldn't tell you that. I haven't drank since my kids have been alive. But actually, it's just a social stigma surrounding alcohol that, in my opinion, my humble opinion, is false. You know, that's not the kind of direct marketing route we're going to take, that alcohol's evil and it's terrible for you. And, you know, most people who I want to buy our products also drink alcohol. This is very much about moderating your alcohol intake, living a cleaner lifestyle, much in the same way that, you know, you work out and look after your body, you can now do that in a bar, you know, by drinking clean. Whereas before, if you're in a bar, it's to get lashed and have fun and forget all about
the old way.
And it's kind of like, I think the younger generation are already doing us a favor. You know, I was discussing with a new girl who works with us today, in the office just today. She said, you know, what is the target? What's your target?
Yeah.
And I said, well, you know, that changes, whether it be here or America, that, you know, the targets are going to be different.
Yeah.
And obviously, if I look at it bird's eye view, the target is anyone who doesn't want to drink an alcoholic drink at that point in time can drink clean. So the target's massive. But ultimately, it's going to be driven by health and making better decisions and a positive life choice, I suppose. But to answer your question from ages ago, if something tastes exactly the same as something else and one is harmful and makes you make terrible decisions and one isn't, I would always choose the clean one. But that's just me. Yeah.
No, not 10 years ago.
No, 10 years ago. I think as well, it's like...
I'm the same.
It's like, I never needed a drink to boost my confidence. Yeah. I'm one of the most naturally, aggressively confident people ever. You know, if you put me up against anything or anyone, I will think that I have a chance, even when I don't. You know, so you know, that's just the way I'm wired. And I don't need alcohol for that. You know, a lot of people, and I understand it, by the way, if some people are, you know, a little bit shy or you know, they need a glass of wine to get them, you know, to the other side of the bar so they can talk to that guy or girl that they like or whatever, fine, have the glass of wine. You know, I'm not preaching saying that you shouldn't be drinking alcohol. I'm just saying that now, you know, we're trying to offer a really viable and reputable alternative slash replacement.
I think you do that well, because I'm the same. 10 years ago, if you'd have launched Clean Co or Clean Liquor, it would have been a much different marketing route. You'd have had to be more aggressive. But now, because of health, and I think less people go out, most people meet online nowadays, you know, so it's not like you need to go out and get smashed to chat to a girl or a guy. It's very different now.
Absolutely. It's complete. Well, I think people, younger people in particular, are keener to spend their income, whatever that may be, on experiences instead of alcoholic liquids that ultimately are, you know, bad for you and make poor decisions. You know, a lot of kids are just doing things differently now. As it happens, our target audience or our demographic currently isn't even the younger generation. We're primarily purchased by, I won't call them middle-aged because it always sounds unkind. Well, I call myself middle-aged, but I think that's more of a kind of self-deprecating joke. Our audience is primarily female, and they're kind of like 30 to 45 year olds who presumably may have children, not all of them obviously, and you know, they enjoy a few gin and tonics in the evening, but prefer to wake up clear-minded, you know, both the kids looked after fine, you know. I know my wife won't mind me saying that she drinks alcohol very rarely, but when she does, she gives it a really good Irish kind of shooing.
She's all in.
Oh, she's all in, but she's out of action then for some time. And, you know, and that's irritating.
Because you've got to do the work.
Well, yeah, there's that. And then there's you know, it's just not the same. Yeah. You know, her mood can be quite affected by alcohol, essentially. Yeah.
Everyone's. I mean, I was just thinking, you talk about decisions. Has anyone ever made a good decision drunk? Like, really?
I think movies do a good job of making it seem like, you know, great decisions are made after a few drinks. But typically,
I don't think I've ever made a good decision hammered.
No. And listen, I totally appreciate, by the way, that like getting hammered can be fun. Like, I don't want to be a hypocrite. I got hammered for many years, you know, regularly and to excess, as I've said before. But my life is so different now that I do wish that I'd gone sober earlier. You know, maybe a good 5 years earlier. You know, had a really good time. Park that, you know, let's try and achieve some great stuff. Because actually that would have been totally impossible before. You know, totally impossible. I kind of grew up with this natural sense of arrogance that I'd always be able to achieve whatever I want.
Where did that come from?
Alcohol got in the way. Like, no, seriously. Like there'd be times when I would wake up and, you know, as a kind of 15, 16 year old, I'd be like, yeah, right, okay, I'm going to be the CEO of some big firm one day, and I'll be minted and I'll drive whatever I want and blah, blah, blah. And it's like, that doesn't just happen.
No.
You know that doesn't happen. Yeah, yeah. Everyone listening knows that that doesn't just happen.
Yeah.
I think there's a great place in life for confidence. If it's completely misplaced, that's a bit of a shame.
Yeah.
You know, it's what they call tragic. But, you know, essentially achieving my goals or giving myself the opportunity to achieve my goals.
Yeah.
Drunk.
Yeah.
Not possible.
No. Or hungover.
No.
That's Bruno just
I love Bruno.
Wafting around.
I want to take Bruno home with me just so that my wife can understand that actually, you know, such a fine beast could live with us.
Well, he's just like, he just sleeps. He's like, I have to carry him around.
He's wonderful.
He's so lazy. When it comes to setting up Clean, how long has it been going?
We sold our first bottle on the 14th of November last year.
Oh,
so
really?
Nearly a year.
So nearly a year.
Yeah.
How much did you have to put in to start it up?
How much did I personally put in?
Or
in,
like the whole company. So is it owned by you half or?
No, so I own.
You and one other guy, right?
Post our Series A round, which we've just closed.
Yeah.
I'm the majority shareholder by some margin.
Okay.
I own about 35% of the company.
Okay, cool. Yeah.
But to get the ball rolling, we had this quite funny conversation actually, because I honestly don't have a business background.
Right.
My family are very business oriented, but yeah. I'm not, never have been. I've always relied on, you know, charm or whatever that might be to kind of get anywhere.
Confidence.
Yeah, confidence. Like hot air balloon, nonsense, confidence. Yeah, with absolutely nothing to back it up. And essentially, wanted to get the ball rolling on this company. Couldn't understand how there wasn't more in the space.
Yeah.
And I literally was just like, I thought I was on to inventing the wheel.
Yeah.
You know, I was literally Facebook. Like, you know, well, yeah. Yeah, Facebook.
Yeah.
No, exactly. But no, genuinely, I was literally like, you know, we're going to be a $1 billion company. There's no question about it. Like when it hit me like a lightning bolt.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Couldn't think of anything more obvious.
Yeah.
I was literally like, the world needs this. Desperate for it. The world. The world's desperate for it.
Yeah.
Yeah. Anyway, and the one player that was in the space at the time just didn't do the obvious thing, you know, on the tin. It just didn't.
What were they doing? Who was it?
It was Seedlip. Okay. So, I don't know if you're aware of that.
No.
Oh, well, there you go.
No.
Okay, so there's one company that started in 2014.
Yeah.
Who made this stuff, Seedlip.
Yeah. Yeah.
And they're an incredible company, by the way. And,
yeah.
and Ben Branson, who started it, is, you know, a bit of a genius. Not Richard's son.
Sam.
I saw your...
Yeah. I was thinking, yeah.
Not him. No, and essentially it's genius. You know,
yeah.
He created non-alcoholic distilled spirits and you know, people mix them with tonic and refer to them as an alcohol-free gin and tonic, which of course it isn't.
Yeah.
And I was wondering, you know, why is there not alcohol-free gin?
Yeah.
You know, and they had these flavors, none of which, you know, were like gin and actually were okay. And I thought, well, I'm going to make a gin and a rum and a whiskey and a tequila and a vodka. And like, you know, and I was Googling and it doesn't exist. Zero. No companies out there doing it. So I got the ball rolling. And now, by the way, there are loads of companies doing it. so we better get our skates on. And essentially, I was in and out of Cork at this little distillery. And we got to a place where we were quite happy with this alcohol-free gin. Then the bloke, like, wouldn't share the recipe and he wouldn't let us into the distillery, and he was like, you know, all the IP remains with us and stuff. And I was just like,
what?
I was like, no. So mm-hmm. So anyways, pulled the plug on that, did a deal with Union Distillers, and essentially got the ball rolling with this guy Justin Hicklin, and he's hilarious, actually awesome guy, been around the block many times.
Yeah,
he's a 60 year old guy who is just cool, calm, collected, gets it, you know, done. Name anything, Justin's done it.
Okay.
You know, if you were like, oh, my dad used to, you know, he was in the start of Marlboro, Justin would go, oh, yes, I was in the start of Marlboro, blah, blah, blah. He's got a kind of story for everything. Great guy.
Yeah.
I remember the day that we were talking about our initial fundraise.
Yeah.
So never fundraised before. And we're kind of throwing numbers around. And we were with this guy, and he said, how much do you think you need?
Yeah.
You know, to get the ball rolling.
Yeah.
And I was like, oh, well, that's going to be 20 grand and that's going to be 10 grand. And, you know, we'll get the bottles for this. And, you know, we're not at scale yet. So, you know, we're going to have to eat into our cost of goods a little bit by, you know, going down this route and not that route. And I don't know, like 100 grand, couple of hundred grand. And he
just making numbers up.
Exactly. Well, I was putting the cost of getting the ball rolling all together and then giving a little cushion after that.
Yeah.
And then thinking, oh, and then we'll sell all of that and that'll generate this money and then we'll pump that money back in.
Yeah.
And it's just like, forgive me for saying if other people think like that, but it's kind of like, it's a bit of a non-starter thinking like that. And I'm sure you know that.
Yeah.
And the guy turned to me, he's like, mate, you need about 3 million quid.
What?
And I went, 3 million quid? I was like, yeah, but exactly, for what? And anyway, we ended up raising 2.1 million quid, which at the time I thought was like this incredibly vast sum of money, but that's to build a team with infrastructure and to, you know, product develop and to just, it's now that I'm a bit more astute with the business thing, other people come to me with business ideas and you sit down with them and, you know, and they think in the kind of old school way of thinking, or how do we get the ball rolling in kind of a small sense? And actually it's just, if you can, just get the thing funded so that you have the room and breathing space to work.
Yeah.
You need to be able to work and you need to be able to execute a plan. And to do that, you need people and you need good people if you want to get it right. And they cost quite a lot of money. And, you know, we had options at the beginning to look at, you know, this MD or this head of marketing or this guy, you know, and then there's the, you know, the other option. And it's kind of like, well, they might smash it out of the park, but it'll be the first time they've ever done it. Or we can hire these guys who, you know, will, so, and it'll diminish the risk.
So 2.1 million quid.
Yeah.
Based on what? A logo and you've been to Cork?
I had a product at that time.
Yeah, okay. What, one product or a few?
No, I had one product at the time. We
hadn't sold anything.
Sold nothing. Yeah.
So you had some, you've been to Cork.
Yeah.
You hung around with
I valued the idea at 5 million quid, by the
way. Of course you did.
Yeah.
Of course you did.
Yeah, yeah.
That's the confidence coming out.
There you go.
Obviously, I mean, you should have went for 10, but whatever.
I started at 20, but I got absolutely nowhere.
Yeah. But still, so 2.1 million
raised
based on a few products and a logo.
They're just one product. So it was just clean gin.
Clean gin, not even clean liquor or clean co.
No, so clean, at the time it was called clean liquor. We had clean gin, okay. And that was it. And we essentially, I think when it comes to raise, everyone understands when they're pumping cash into a business that you need enough cash for the ball to roll.
Yeah.
You know, there's no point in raising a small amount of money that's going to dissipate and be gone in 3 months. And you go back to the same people and you go, well, actually we need more money.
Yeah.
And they go, but you're no further ahead than you were 3 months ago. So this is beginning to feel like I've made a bad investment. You know, so I think actually if you're able to sell the dream and to explain the category to people in a way, or in this case, just the idea and where it could go to people in a way that makes sense and raise enough money to get the ball rolling properly.
Yeah.
It's going to be far easier to progress and far easier to kind of make waves as such.
Yeah.
It's if you get to the end of that run rate and you're no further ahead and you've got no listings and people aren't really buying into the product, then you're in trouble. We just raised a further 7.
Really?
So we've done 9.1 in the last 10 months.
Wait. Let's just go back before we get to that. So the other thing is with this type of market that you're in, like you're kind of first to market, not first to market, but almost first.
Yeah.
Like you said earlier, there's tons on the market.
Yeah.
Also,
well, there is now, yeah.
Now there is, in not even, 11 months? If you wouldn't have raised that money, those other people that are entering the market could have overtook you.
Yeah.
Because you're first and you have the backing, then you can kind of like act like you're first to market in a sense.
I suppose, yeah. I mean,
if you wouldn't have raised money,
it's estimated that 83% of people in the UK have no idea this market exists. So even the players in the market are only playing to like 17% of people.
Yeah.
And we obviously aim to, you know, vastly increase that number through household penetration. So through marketing and just building brands and actually investing into the category and into supermarkets and being more visible and being louder and creating, like your friends Oatly outside, you know, creating some outdoor advertising campaigns that resonate with people and make sense, you know, perhaps driven by humor.
Yeah.
You know, I think a lot of people in this country take themselves really seriously. And, you know, we're 4 times distilled.
Of course. Blah,
blah, blah. And it's just like...
And you'll have like actual huge brands in alcohol trying to jump in on it as well.
coming next year,
of course, and they'll be using their staff and their
they have existing brands. You know, I won't say who they are coming out because I'm not sure we're supposed to know, but there are some major alcohol brands that are about to release zeros, you know, following in Heineken Zero's footsteps. We were amongst the first to do it for spirits. They bring big brand names to it, so you know, you can just attach the word zero to your already existing big gin brand, people know what they're buying. It's actually going to do wonders for the category because it's going to open people's eyes. It's going to penetrate houses. It's going to, you know, people will realize it's more of a thing. You know, me and my 750,000 Instagram followers can't change the way a nation thinks, unfortunately, but you know, a big alcohol brand can at least open the door.
So the first raise was 2.1. Based on one drink that you made in Cork. And lots of confidence.
Plenty of confidence.
Anyone watching this with confidence is literally going to start writing this shit up.
And I hope so.
And okay, since then, you've raised another 7 million. I wish I could see the people that have invested in this just to see what they look like.
Some of our investors are like incredible investors who wouldn't have...
They're smart. Yeah. To get rich, you have to be pretty smart anyway.
Mate, honestly, I look at our cap table sometimes and I'm just like, it's incredible.
So 7 million, that's 9.1, right? In that, since you got the first 2.1, how much revenue is it brought in?
We aim to turn out, we're on track and ahead of our plan to turn over 3 million in our first financial year.
Which is amazing.
Congrats. Which is very good.
That's amazing.
We enjoy a pole position in Sainsbury's on a 12-week rolling basis and a year-to-date basis. So, you know, all of these brands, you know, Cedars, which is owned by Pernod Ricard, and Seedlip, which is owned by Diageo, are second to us in Sainsbury's, you know, which is kind of alarming considering they have, you know, they have so much money behind them. And if they wanted to turbocharge the category, they probably could. But, you know, we're...
And Diageo, they've got insane amount of brands, haven't they?
Yeah. This won't be Diageo's top priority at this stage. But it's, you know, we're probably, I would have thought, the most interesting independent Nolo brand in the world. At the moment. And we're kind of across it in a pretty major way. I would say that though, obviously. but I think as a kind of value proposition, we're the most interesting.
Yeah, for sure. So how's the next sort of 3 years looking for CleanCo?
Pretty aggressive, mate. Obviously. The seven is going to be used. So the Series A that we've just shut, the 7 mil, is going to be used primarily to drive household penetration here in the UK.
Okay.
So we're going to go massive on marketing. Clean January or Dry January.
Okay.
It's going to be huge for us. New products, new everything, complete rebrand, hopefully shelves everywhere. You can't miss us, billboards, advertising, TV, the lot, you know, boom.
So a huge part of that's going into advertising and marketing.
Quite a lot of it will be going into advertising and marketing, just growing the awareness of the general category.
Yeah.
I think alcohol-free beer has taken off in such a major way because Heineken lent into it and pumped a ton of money into marketing. Alcohol-free beer has been around for about 18 years, by the way.
Yeah.
But like, it's just something that no one would have drank before because the product wasn't good enough.
Calibre.
Yeah?
Calibre. There was a non-alcohol beer called Calibre. My dad had a restaurant when I was a kid. So this is older than 18 years.
Yeah.
And they had it was alcohol-free.
Yeah, well, there you go.
Nobody bought it.
Yeah, because perhaps with the right investment and the right messaging behind Calibre, people would have bought into it.
Yeah.
It took those funny ads of the guy driving down Hollywood Boulevard or whatever with beer bottles all over his car and getting pulled over to wake people, you know.
Which ad was that?
I don't even know if I'm kind of making it up. There was an ad where the guy gets pulled over because he's drinking a Heineken Zero as he's driving.
Mm-hmm.
And the policeman pulls him over and he just taps the side of the bottle, doesn't he?
Okay.
And shows him the zero and the policeman lets him go.
Okay, fine.
Which of course is funny, right? Because no one associates drinking something that looks like a Heineken with driving.
And
it's all part of the fun, isn't it? And the Heineken Zero is fantastic. It's delicious.
Yeah.
Lucky Saint is another brand that's fantastic, independent beer. So I think people's eyes are being open to the category a bit more. And the stuff that we're doing at the moment with the product development, we're really looking to move from that kind of half sensible alternative to wow, that's I can't tell the difference.
Yeah,
and we're very much underway with that.
Do you remember the Pepsi Coke challenge?
Yeah,
of course. Have you done that?
We if I'm honest, we never went down that line of marketing at the moment because I think that our...
But you can't, because you'd have hammered people in supermarkets because they'll be trying one that's alcohol and one that's non, but they'll just be, by the end of it, they'll be hammered.
There's that. Well, also our products are fantastic, but they are alternatives. Yeah. You know, like if you're looking to have your head blown off by our product to the point where you can't believe it's not gin, we're not quite there yet.
Yeah, you know,
if you mix it as a gin and tonic,
you
will be pleasantly surprised that it tastes delicious.
Yeah.
It's not gonna trick an alcoholic into thinking that you're back on the sesh. Do you know what I mean?
I really want to try it.
Like, yeah, I feel stupid for not bringing you some. As soon as we finish here, I'm gonna get some sent over.
Thanks.
And you can have it all on your back bar and enjoy a nice clean G&T whenever you feel like it.
So the next sort of year, there's a big advertising campaign, because my background's advertising, marketing and branding. And so I'm always like intrigued by different campaigns. And I've, since uni, which was like 18 years ago, I follow campaigns, and all the ones that used to win awards, I was obviously like, you know, into all that kind of stuff. And I would see all the ones that, so I'm kind of interested to see, obviously, like even Movember.
Yeah.
Yeah. That was like a huge thing. That's come out of an ad campaign. You're talking about a dry Jan thing.
Mm.
I kind of want to know what you're going to do in January, if you're going to create like a Movember or you're going to create like a...
We're having a lot of fun at the moment. This is the kind of side of the business, the product development and the advertising of it is kind of what I love doing.
Fun, yeah.
I wouldn't say that I'm a marketeer by any stretch of the imagination, as Dean Lavender will attest to. He's our head of marketing.
Yeah,
he literally is like, everything goes through me. Okay,
all really?
Right. Yes.
Is that how he talks?
Yes. Yeah. Well, he will obviously disagree, but yeah, that is how he talks. And essentially, we just want to make sure we get the messaging right. There's a big education piece that comes with this.
Yeah.
You know, like, we may think that, oh, well, it's just, you know, it's gin that won't get you drunk is enough. But actually, the next question would be, well, what's the point?
Yeah.
You know, and we need to cover that
in
the advert. You know, otherwise you're just going to be left with a bunch of people not buying it and not understanding what it is.
Yeah.
So we're deep in thought as to whether or not we want to be a challenger brand or competing within a competitive set, or whether we're, you know, pro, you know, innovation and the future, or are we health, or, you know, there's we're throwing a lot of things around at the minute just to try and make sure we get that messaging right.
Yeah.
We're working with Mother and Broody, the brand agency. Do you know them?
Yeah, I know Mother, yeah. They're in Shoreditch, aren't they?
Yeah. So they've just come up with that really cool IKEA advert. Have you seen it?
No, it's one?
It's like, it's got that... like can of Red Bull on it that just says like sleep. It's like an energy drink, and then there's like vitamin pills, and it says sleep on there as well. And it's kind of all things that you would usually associate with energy.
Yeah.
They've turned into, but it starts with a good night's sleep.
Okay.
You know, which obviously for the beds is
makes sense.
It's great. Yeah. So it was very clever and very smart. And as soon as I saw that, I was like, make sure it's as good as that. So, but no, we're in touch kind of all the time, and it's great. I think the kind of world of advertising and marketing is such an interesting one. And I absolutely love it. And it's great when
ideas are the best thing in the world.
Nothing gives me kind of more pleasure, I suppose, than seeing an advert that's just amazing, you know. And I think it has to be driven. I do think this brand has to be driven by humor.
Yeah.
I think the more seriously an alcohol-free spirit brand takes himself.
If you talk about Red Bull, Red Bull's a great example. No one knew what Red Bull was, apart from it just basically injects your eyes with like adrenaline. It comes from like this syrup in Thailand. But it was like the simplest advert, and it was a cartoon. Red Bull gives you wings.
Yeah, amazing.
It's so simple and so different because it was a cartoon, and it wasn't even like a proper cartoon. It was like static. And it just took over, and Red Bull's what, the biggest brand in the world. I mean, imagine you could do that with yours.
But that's why it's kind of so exciting, because you know.
Do you have a strap line?
We're playing around with a flu. We were playing around with a few. It kind of depends on the direction that you're going. When we initially were looking at kind of making the hangover the target.
Yeah.
You know, like initially we were looking at alcohol as the target.
Yeah.
Then we thought we'd be alienating a lot of our customers because they also drink alcohol, and you don't want to make people who drink alcohol feel like they shouldn't be drinking alcohol because it's preachy. So people turn around and they say, "Fuck off!" You know, like I'll drink whatever I want. In fact, I'll have a beer right now. You know,
and double straight.
Yeah, exactly. and so kind of you really want to try to not tell people what to do whilst telling them to buy your product.
Yeah.
So
yeah.
So we had "Should Have Gone Clean" as a strap line at one point, and you know, the play would have been, you know, terrible situations in which you're clearly hungover, you know, should have gone clean.
Yeah, too obvious, though.
It's
too obvious.
Well, let's hope we don't use that one then.
No, don't use that. No, it's got to be positive. It's got to reinforce a positive thing.
Yeah.
Like, what you're doing is positive.
Yeah.
You know, you're removing hangovers, removing bad decisions, removing all these things.
You probably don't follow me or whatever. Did you see my...
I started following you 2 days ago.
Okay, did you see my less of a dick advert?
No.
Okay, so...
Hold on, what?
I came up with... Well, actually, it was one of the early Motherworks. So we were looking at something and it said, guaranteed to make you less of a dick.
Yeah. And this is about CleanCo.
This isn't like our strap line, obviously, but it was something that was mocked up as part of a bit of fun for perhaps a billboard, say, for example.
With you on it?
Yes, yeah, so I thought, no, initially it didn't have me on it. And okay, I was in the office and I was reading it and I was like, God, I can't believe we had that. And then I was like, actually, with me on it, that's really funny, because obviously a lot of people associate me with being a bit of a dick. So I shot this, I'll get it out for you in a sec. We shot this kind of picture of me like, holding a bottle, really looking like kind of the world's biggest knob, essentially. And then it was really simple. It just said, "Go clean this October." And then I kind of pop in, it just says, "Guaranteed to make you less of a dick." And that was it. And actually, like...
But you didn't use it.
Well, I posted it on my just social. I think hopefully we'll come up with something.
If you think about it, how, like, as a percentage, 90% of people that know CleanCo don't know you're involved, probably.
Do you think?
I don't know. I'd say so.
I think CleanCo
is... Not 90%, but it will get to that. It will get to a point where no one will know.
I'm absolutely hoping that at one point, CleanCo is so big and so famous and no one knows that I'm involved. Or, you know, only the people at the start know that I was involved. That's where...
That's the thing. If you have that ad, then they won't know, right?
I think at this stage, any kind of fuel that I can pour on it, mm-hmm. whether it be, and this is why it has to be funny, because it's actually impossible to go from dick on TV to serious businessman in the mind of the public. It's like, it's...
Saying that though, like before we started this, I've never seen Made in Chelsea.
Oh, thank God.
I actually said to someone yesterday, I said he was on The Only Way is Chelsea. That's what I said.
A lot of people say that.
I was like, I've never seen it, right?
Good.
So like I said earlier, I watched a few clips earlier, but I literally know nothing about the show. So for me, and so say for the future of your demographic, your audience, most of them will never have seen the show. Or probably not anyway in the UK.
God, that's so nice to hear.
That's only the UK, right? Because obviously this is going to be everywhere.
Yeah.
I assume you're not just planning on the UK.
So, No. We're looking... we're going to dip our toe into Los Angeles next year.
Yeah.
Just to test the old waters over there. But no, it's... I think the whole... And I'm not referring to myself as a celebrity here, but I think the celebrity-driven drinks brand piece is quite recognized now. Diageo obviously acquired George Clooney and Randy Gerber's tequila for $1 billion when it was loss-making. They were doing like 150,000 cases a year or something.
That's it.
And Ryan Reynolds's tequila, Aviation, was just acquired for $610 million.
It's gin, isn't it?
Yeah, in America. Gin in America. Small market.
It's got tequila or it's got gin?
Gin. Aviation gin.
Aviation gin.
Yeah. $610 million.
For what? What, he sold it?
Yeah.
Huh?
He made about $300 million.
No.
Yeah.
What a legend.
Yes, I know. Yeah. But my point is, they were turning over So both those deals were done on like 28 times revenue. 28 times. So like
revenue, not profit.
Yeah, yeah, revenue. So actually, pump it full of, you know, it's kind of
Conor McGregor's whiskey then must be churning.
Yeah, it could be.
It must be.
So, but my point is, so Diageo, from my perspective, it almost looks as though they're making these brands famous through these big brand acquisitions. So essentially, like the brands were famous anyway, but I guarantee you that they're doing enormous sales because of the news of the sale. So there's not a single person that I know who didn't send me that Ryan Reynolds article.
That's good PR. You know,
because, because all of a sudden aviation gin is massively on the map, because it's like, wait, what? Right. And like, you know, and I think it was the highest selling liquid on Amazon for about a week afterwards. You know, it, just the sales of aviation would have gone through the roof. So we're in discussions with all sorts of interesting people over in the States. To see how we can give this the biggest platform it can have, essentially.
That ad of you saying don't be less of a, sorry, be less of a dick, or don't
guaranteed be, to make you less of a dick.
See, that kind of makes sense in that respect.
Yeah, yeah, exactly. But that, I think if, put it this way, you know, Made in Chelsea, as an example of a show that gave me some notoriety.
Some?
Well, yeah, a little bit.
I never watched it and I knew who you were.
Oh, well, there you go. Well, there you go. No, but my point is, you know, I think if you can attach someone that you're familiar with, even if it's in a negative way, to a brand, you're going to know more about the brand straight away. It's kind of like, you know, if we all of a sudden have national distribution and we're up against Diageo and Pernod Ricard and all these, you know, big titans, the fact that you may know that it's that advert with me in it, or oh, that's that brand that Spencer Matthews is involved with, or whatever. I think you'd be more likely to recognize it, you know, in the UK with me attached to it, which is obviously a good thing for the brand. But like, you know, I think
it's good. But you obviously, there's a hesitation, because long term you don't want that, right? You want it to just, it's just going to be everywhere globally, hopefully, fingers crossed, touch wood. It will be everywhere. So, but I get, you kind of got to get to the next level somehow.
I think, you know, to give it the start that it's had, it was necessary to play on, you know, my TV career.
And your audience.
You know, for sales and stuff. If I go down Instagram and I say, right, it's Sober October, who wants to give CleanCo a try? That's a natural leg up to the business you know, some of our competitors don't have. So of course we'll use that. but essentially it's also, but I live and breathe it, you know, it's my life. It's not, this isn't me trying to generate cash out of something that's completely, you know, pointless. This to me, I do believe that this will change the way millions of people see alcohol. I believe that it'll help millions of people. And I believe that it'll make the world a better place. And genuinely, it's my, as well as my children and wife, my passion and my life. So when I, you know, constantly push it, I don't feel like I'm boring people, though I probably am.
Yeah, you're lying to anyone. You genuinely, well, it come from your idea in the first place.
Exactly.
Yeah.
I can't bear it when you look at some influencers and they're just selling you whatever, like whoever will pay you whatever. You know, I find that annoying, which is why I do very little of it. I was about to say I don't do it, but you know, you do from time to time, because it's attractive.
Code Spencer.
10%. There you go. There'll be a code when this comes out. Don't worry, guys. All good. But you know, I think it's I think you'd be mad not to leverage whatever kind of platform you were given from TV.
Yeah, it makes sense. And you know what's funny? I've been running Mobile for like 13 years. And people used to say, oh, why don't you have an alcohol brand? I'm like, well, I would never mix alcohol with driving. You know, it's hard enough, you know, because people go, oh, everyone gets hammered every night and then they drive the next day. I'm like, well, no, there's like five in some cars is five.
Yeah.
You know, and there's always someone that doesn't, you know, and always, you know, so it's fine. And people used, I think a couple of companies did, and they were like, want to sponsor parties. But I was like, I don't want to be associated with alcohol, because then it looks like I'm promoting drink driving.
Yeah.
But now, like so long later, you know, companies like CleanCo and Clean Liquor and all that kind of stuff, like there's like, it actually makes sense, because it's like some people that come on my events, they don't drink. They come on it because they love cars.
Yeah.
You know, they want to travel and go to beautiful hotels, and, you know, they come on with their wives or, you know, husbands, whatever, and they just have a nice holiday. So although a lot of the marketing and branding is kind of like, you know, partying and all that kind of stuff, which people do, there's a huge side of it that isn't like that.
Yeah.
And so it's like communicating, that's always been quite tough, you know. So it's interesting there are brands now where, if you look at smoking, it's like people are vaping, people are doing all these, so many different things now to get away from it, so it's not harmful for themselves.
Yeah.
It kind of makes sense. It's like a natural transition. You just hit it early. You just done well.
Yeah, yeah. Well, you know, we're at the kind of, I suppose, e-cigarette stage of the smoking to vaping thing. You know, like for somebody who smokes cigarettes to go straight to a vape is a massive jump in one's mind.
Yeah.
But if you create an e-cigarette that, look, I don't know if you remember, but the early e-cigarettes were just white.
Okay.
And the consumer, customer, whatever, had, you know, they had to make the tips that go in your mouth look like orange, like a cigarette. So, the, you know, that was too much of a jump, that it was all white. It's like, oh, I don't, you know, I don't want you. So it had to look more like a cigarette. So in the same way that we try to make our drinks look and feel like the spirits that they're representing.
Yeah.
You know, I feel that, you know, just creating a liquid that tastes like nothing, you know, nothing you're used to, is too far a step at this stage. You need to keep it really close to, that's why.
Yeah.
Heineken Zero does well, because it tastes the same.
It's in a can, isn't it? Or a bottle.
Yeah, lovely bottle.
So what's your job title?
Like, I'm the founder and CEO.
Founder and CEO.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Although, I do feel we've hired some.
I'm laughing because you're laughing at that yourself.
Well, only because, like, you know, there. I wouldn't.
So adult.
I wouldn't say I was your kind of typical CEO. I'm in the office every day and I'm across everything.
Yeah.
But some of the stuff that some of these lads, you know, produce, who work with us, for us, whatever you want to say, is amazing.
Yeah.
Like, and you know, are there people who could do a better job than me as CEO of my own company? Yeah, 100%. But like, you know, I'll always be the founder.
Yeah.
And I love, you know, CEOing it, but I have to say the learning curve has been so steep.
In a year, of course.
But like, you know, I had no experience at all of running a business before.
Yeah.
And now, you know, the team is growing just so aggressively, and we're making these kind of key hires of people who've been in this industry, in this business for many, many years. And they have, you know, a lot of the answers to a lot of my questions.
Yeah.
And like, sometimes I feel a bit like, cool, carry on.
Yeah, yeah. Like that kid that wanted to be a CEO when you were younger.
Yeah, yeah, exactly. But you know, I feel, you know, I'm a leader who's happy to be led, I suppose.
Yeah, yeah,
And I feel that you can't become, you know, an incredible leader without learning from incredible people.
You
know, it doesn't just happen.
Yeah.
So I do feel like I'm at the kind of early stages of my CEO development, I suppose. I suppose it's odd that I would have that title at this early stage, and I certainly wouldn't be the CEO of this company if I hadn't founded it.
Yeah.
I said to Lightspeed, though, Lightspeed were in a big American fund who pumped in $1 million quite early days, and they said, I said to them, I was like, you know, what happens to me when this thing, you know, takes off, all being well, you know, surely I'm not going to CEO the thing. I've got no experience of being CEO.
Yeah.
And the lady, I haven't asked her if I can name her, so I probably won't. So she said, she was like, no, we invest in the idea and the founder.
Yeah.
You know, she was like, I love your energy and the way you see the business.
Yeah.
So she was like, you are CEOing it all day long.
Yeah.
You know, that's, she was like, if you need someone to do the Excel stuff, you know, there'll be someone to help, you know, and she just said, it's very important that you harness it and you lead it yourself. And I said, well, great. You know, I was just hoping that, you know, she wasn't going to turn around with some list of demands that, you know, I would have no idea about, but actually they're remarkably good partners.
Yeah, no, a CEO, people confuse what a CEO does a lot. Because a CEO could be of a tiny business or an airline.
Yeah.
You know, a CEO of an airline is not the person that come up with the idea, but a CEO of a company like yours is generally the heart of the idea and what brings it back to what it should be, you know, because if you get tons of shareholders that want to have like a million different ideas just to pump money and make more money, then you're the guy that would be like, well, that's not what I did this for.
Yeah.
Right. And that person always needs to be there. Same with me and Modball. People would say, oh, you should do this. And I'm like, well, no, that's, if I do that, it will change the idea of it. And this is why I originally did it, you know?
Yeah.
So because of that, I wouldn't change it. You know, I'd rather someone create a new one themselves and do their own thing. you know, and go off and, you know, for me, I love it because it was my idea. I've like, you know, nurtured it over so long and I've seen it grow and, you know, kind of stuff. That's like, you know.
It's awesome though to see it kind of growing and blossoming and kind of, we call it the flywheel, you know, those bicycles where you get the big heavy wheel going and then it's like impossible to stop it. You know, that's how it kind of feels.
Yeah.
In the office. And actually I couldn't be more fortunate with the team. I just think they're just incredible. Someone asked me the other day about kind of best mates or friends in general. And it's just like the only people in my life are my family and the clean team.
Yeah.
And I love all of them, like genuinely. So I'd be happy to leave it at that.
I was saying the other day to someone, you only have 7 days in a week. Yeah. And in those 7 days, you're asleep for a third of it, you know, and you add on your kids, your time. You got to be careful who you spend your time with because you want to learn, you want to grow and you want to have fun. So, you know, your team around you, how many people are in the team?
There's 14 of us in the office, but I think we aim to be 28 by June next year in the plan, I think. So that we're growing pretty quickly and it's good though. I mean, back in the early days when it was literally just Justin and me, it felt like we were like a circus act. It was just like plates spinning everywhere, like a plate on each finger, spinning and plates crashing down. And then we hired this most incredible MD who's at Innocent and Mars and Nestle. And he does some seriously heavy lifting for us. But then, you know, he's really the one who makes me feel like, oh my God, like the light on, don't have his job. It's like, the amount on his plate at all times. Like I'll come into the office, I'll be like, oh mate, have you got 5 minutes? He's like, not really, mate. It's just like, what? I'm only joking. No, we certainly kind of chat all the time, but he's just like, his day is, you know, you read about all these big CEOs and business people who have, you know, their day set out in like 10-minute increments, or like Elon Musk's day apparently is broken down into 5-minute increments or something that's completely uncontrollable. And it's
imagine
like,
imagine that.
Well, it also can't be true. Like, what if your car's late or whatever?
Yeah.
The train's delayed or your whole day is like, So exactly. So I think, you know, those things are to be taken with a bit of a pinch of salt. I do know some people who are so busy that like you getting them on the phone is, you know, almost impossible.
Yeah, yeah.
And I find that difficult, especially when those people have like kids in a family. It's like, it's, you know,
it can't be true. The reality is they've got someone stopping all the idiots getting through to them.
Yeah. Well, there you go. Maybe
I've got Rosie.
No, but exactly. So I don't know. No, Dave is obviously, he's got time, but it's, you know, some people's plates, I suppose, at the company are fuller than others.
Yeah.
But it's exciting because there's always, incredible things happening. There's loads of momentum behind us.
Yeah.
Like sales are through the roof. We're on for a record month. You know, we're eyeing up America. We're talking to distribution partners in Australia and Benelux. And it's kind of like, you know, end of next year, we could have, you know, quite a cool little, albeit niche in certain areas of the world, like global brand.
Yeah.
Which is a million miles away from where I was 2 years ago.
Yeah. You know,
wondering where my next drink was.
Was it only 2 years ago?
Yeah, 2.5 years ago, I stopped drinking. But crazy. Like, you know, it was, I mean, so chances of achieving my full potential were pretty slim.
At the time. Well, this shows how quickly it can change.
Well, this is my message that, you know, I don't want to be too preachy about, but it's kind of like, if only I could share with everyone the legitimate difference in what stopping drinking did for me, it's unfathomable.
Honestly
it's like, and I have friends who kind of, you know, drink quite regularly and blah blah blah, and I say to them now, I'm just like, listen mate, I'm not your dad, and I, you know, you don't have to do what I say, but if you cut drinking out of your life, you could be the most, you know, influential, incredible productive person. You could change the world potentially.
Well, they're not ready to. They might in the future.
Maybe
like someone said to you 5 years ago, you'd be like, I'm all right. I'm still 27.
I think it's a hard thing to believe until you've
it's true.
Actually kind of tasted a bit of it, or like sat across from, you know, billionaire investors who are just so smart, and you can see they're listening to you and they're engaging with you, and then they write you a, you know, big check, and you're just like,
And they're not hungover.
God, I couldn't have done that. Yeah, and yeah. They don't drink. You know,
yeah.
And you leave that meeting thinking, you know, not even that you've pulled wool or anything. It's just like, I've achieved something there.
Yeah.
Because that bloke is fucking serious.
Yeah.
Do you know what I mean? And he sees me as fucking serious. Yeah. And that is epic.
Yeah.
And actually that feeling is more addictive than any drink I've ever had.
It's true.
I'm on this kind of optimal journey that I just want to harness and just continue growing.
Do you go to the gym a lot?
At the moment, I'm in the gym all the time. I'm doing an 11 page men's health piece.
Oh, yeah.
I only say that it's 11 pages because apparently it's quite a big spread for men's health. They won't give me the cover.
They'll give me 11 pages.
Something's obviously wrong with them. No, they won't give me the cover. I think Chris Hemsworth might be doing the cover. Oh. Is everyone not a bit bored of him?
Yeah, no, super
not,
bored.
Not really. Me neither. Yeah. Love him.
Have you met him?
I love Chris Hemsworth.
Have you met him?
I have not met him.
I've met him. Super have boring.
You? Is
so,
he?
So boring.
He's not boring.
Honestly, one of the most boring guys I've ever met.
No, he's not. Actually, it makes me feel a lot better. Is he actually? No, he's not.
Genuinely. Okay. Genuinely. I honestly thought he was a bit dead inside.
Right.
Yeah.
Okay.
Anyway.
Well, there we go. Well, anyway, he's getting the cover, which is great.
It was that bad that I'm actually saying something. Normally, I'd just be like, oh, yeah, it's fine.
Oh.
But I was like, oh, my God, is this guy alive? Or
That's a real shame.
He probably just hates everyone. Imagine all the people coming up to him all the time.
It would be boring being him, to be honest.
He probably hated me.
So but actually, fine. Like, there's so much misconception around fame as well.
Yeah.
You know, and actually, we won't go into it now, obviously, but I feel, you know, social media in particular is like so dangerous because everyone wants to be famous, everyone wants to be recognized, everyone wants to be followed.
Yeah.
But actually, like, as you just said, like being Chris Hemsworth would be fucking horrible.
I can't think of anything worse.
Imagine being Justin Bieber.
Oh my God.
Imagine. Honestly, imagine walking down the street and like needing security because like literally everyone would just like it would be awful.
I enjoy
popping to the co-op.
Yeah.
Yeah. And grabbing some ham and like some Oatly.
But you're quite famous.
Not really, though. Yeah. Not when you look at them.
Yeah,
you know?
It's like
if I pop into co-op, one person might ask me for a photo, maybe, that's perfect.
It's okay.
Well, that's great.
Two, you're like getting the knife out.
Yeah, you know, queue starts to form. You start thinking, kids. I only came here for some Weetabix. You know what I mean? And look at what's happening.
Some rollers.
Place of light. Yeah, exactly. Yeah. No, so I think. Actually,
they must absolutely, it must be awful. It must drain your soul.
Being at the top of the Z list is where you want to be. So, you know, you want to be at the top of a kind of shit celebrity pool.
Really?
You want to be at the top of that. You don't want to be anywhere near A-list, mate. That would just be awful.
Yeah.
Imagine it.
Well, I've never wanted to be famous.
Right.
The only thing that I've said that I would ever do if it was on TV is become a dragon. Be a dragon on Dragon's Den. That's the only thing that I would do.
You and me both, mate.
Yeah. Okay, let's do it.
Let's do it.
Yeah.
We can split the quarter mil and share a seat if you want.
We'll sit on each other's laps.
Yeah.
But like legitimately, that's the only thing that I would do on TV.
Yeah.
Like I've had options before, but I'm like, I find it's just not for me. Like,
What do you think of the Den? What do you think of the Den?
I think as a show, it's a business show. The thing with it, it's on BBC Two. It's in 180 countries or something ridiculous. Like, I think if that number might not be right, but it's everywhere. So it would never not be on TV, right? The BBC will always have that on BBC Two. It takes a week to shoot it. It couldn't be more perfect. You spend a week investing in companies. You come away owning a couple of companies that you love, and they're going to carry on working. You make some money out of it. Brilliant. You get paid to be on it. It's a week's work. It couldn't be a better show.
No. I get the concept of being on it. Like, I just mean, like, I struggle with some of the deal structures, and it brings me actually really nicely back to our initial point of at the very beginning.
Yeah.
I feel that almost everyone in the Den undervalues their business. And I feel that...
Not everyone. Well, there's a couple of people on there. Like, I want 2 million quid. What?
Yeah, but that's interesting. Like when you watch Shark Tank, it's way more fun because they go in and they're like, crazy. I want $3 million for 10% of my business. And that's like, yes, mate.
Yeah.
Yes.
That's you.
So mine would have been 7 million for 20%.
Yeah. Based on?
Based on a multiple of future turnover or the size of the opportunity or, you know, other brands in the space or just, you know, actually what we did the 7 million for the 20% on was this is the money that we need to execute this plan.
Yeah.
you know, we've done this so far with this much money. Stands to reason because of this metric that if we pour this much money on that, then it will, you know, it'll double up and triple up to here. We did a big piece on household penetration. 0.8% of households currently have a non-alcoholic spirit, and it's not even 1%. If we can get that number to just 4%, you know, we're playing in a billion-dollar category.
Sure.
You know, and essentially, I delivered that in such a way that people went, well, yeah, in my opinion, that's obviously going to happen. And I go, great, cool, let's go.
Because 7 million quid, some people's nothing. Like, it's just absolutely nothing. What I haven't got my head around is how you got the 2 million based on nothing.
Well, we needed 2 million quid.
Yeah, I know, but how was it? Yeah, but you'd literally not sold anything.
No, so I had the product though. So the people who invested could taste the product.
Okay, so we're on Dragon's Den.
Yeah.
Right now, we are on Dragon's Den. I'm a dragon.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay.
You come in, you're fresh off the boat from Cork.
Yeah.
With this bottle of clean liquor.
Yeah.
And you're like, go.
Okay.
Tell me how you do it. I'll be the dragon.
Okay. I'm trying to think of how much we sold initially.
Here's your bottle of gin. Actually, there's your bottle of clean liquor. That one. You can have your glass.
Okay. Yeah, yeah.
All right, here we go.
Yeah, but I'm trying to figure out, do you want to do the Series A round?
Yeah, the first one. I'm still baffled how you got 2 million without selling a product.
Okay. Well, it's very, it's easy, isn't it?
We need some Dragon's Den music. Okay, we'll edit some music into this. Right, ready? Go.
I need 2.1 million pounds.
Yeah.
For 20% of my business.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. How many have you sold in the last year?
We haven't launched yet. This is pre-launch.
Brilliant.
In fact, you are amongst the first people to ever try this revolutionary product.
Okay. So you want 2 million quid of my kids' future inheritance.
Well, if you choose to invest it in them, then...
Based on nothing.
Well... Like, I have it for you to taste,
yeah,
and I'll explain to you the value of the opportunity.
Okay.
If you give me the option.
Okay, so because I'm trying to think, because I'm fairly decent at communicating, selling ideas, blah blah blah.
Mm-hmm.
Who invested in it? Was it a consortium, or was it like a group of people, or just one person?
There's a few high net worth individuals
that you knew personally.
Yeah. It's essentially a family and friends round. When we were about 400k off closing that round, I met with a woman from Lightspeed.
Okay.
Venture partners. They were behind.
For the last 400 grand.
Yeah.
Okay.
So they were behind Goop, Snapchat. Bunch of, you know, big brands essentially. Yeah. Calm.
Yeah.
And we had lunch. I was reading an article that sounded like it was written about me.
Right.
And I'm not arrogant enough to think that everything's written about me, by the way. But like,
was it written about you?
No. Okay. I was reading a piece of press about beating the three-tier distribution system in America and how young entrepreneurs are looking to revolutionize the beverage space, you know, right, the RTD, ready to drink beverage space, okay, and alcoholic space, and is alcohol dead? And it was written by a woman called Ashley Brazier at Lightspeed Venture Partners. All of the points that she was hitting were just couldn't have been more in line
with you,
with what we stood for,
right,
essentially, and beating the three-tier distribution system, which has always been a part of the plan for America. And I went on to Lightspeed, the website.
You got in touch with her?
Yeah, got in touch with her, and I said,
real entrepreneur this is. This is like confidence over.
And I said, I feel like the article that you wrote about beating the three-tier distribution system was written about me. And I've started this, I'm in the process of starting this company that is alcohol-free liquor, low alcohol liquor. And I'd really love to talk to you. And she said, can you chat in half an hour? Yeah. And I said, sure. And it was, I think it was like 11:30 or midnight, you know, my time. My wife thought I was a complete arsehole for
chatting some woman.
Yeah, you know, exactly. Hang on a sec, darling. just calling Ashley. And I pop next door. And we had this kind of really long conversation. And it kind of felt like we knew each other. And she said, my partner, who is a partner of Lightspeed, is going to be in the UK in a couple of weeks, would you take her for lunch and bring some of the product? And I said, yeah. And we had lunch and we had a chat. And she was like, what did she say? She said, we'll do $2 million. And I said, I don't have room for that. We've only got 400 grand left. And Lightspeed get involved really early stage, by the way.
And at Lightspeed.
Yeah, exactly. No, but they get involved really early stage. It's kind of like this particular lady invests in founders' ideas at, you know, concept stage, essentially.
Yeah.
By this point, it might be worth mentioning that we had secured a Sainsbury's listing. So we had taken the product around a few retailers and spoken to some buyers, and we'd secured a Sainsbury's listing. And that for her was like, the concept's proven. You're going to be in 496 Sainsbury's stores. You know, yeah, great, let's go.
Had you confirmed that at that point?
She didn't do 2 million, by the way. So we agreed on 1 million because she...
Dollars.
So she said, we'll do £2 million. And I said, the whole round is 2.1, and I've already raised, you know...
1.5.
And she said, well, I won't do 400. You know, the minimum I'll do is 1 million. And I was like, oh, but that makes us oversubscribed by this and that, and it means I'm going to have to sell more equity. And she literally just said, I was like, couldn't have been more rookie at this stage.
Yeah.
And she just said, I'll let you think about it for like, like a day. But she was like, trust me, you want to take the deal.
Yeah.
And I was like, okay. And I called my brother afterwards and I was like, so I had lunch with Lightspeed and like, they said the minimum they'll do is 1 million. And he was like, are you fucking joking? And I was just like, I was like, no. And he was like, well, yeah, I'll obviously take it. And I was like, oh no, but I only need 400. He was like, take it. So we took it.
You sell more of your shares then?
The whole company just diluted a bit.
Okay.
At the moment, at that time, it was just me and Justin. So yeah, essentially I diluted a lot more than I would have wanted to, but we have Lightspeed in our camp now, which is kind of high end.
Yeah. So 1.5 was family and friends.
Yeah, not so much family.
No,
but yeah, more
people
more
kind of in your network.
I suppose so. Yeah.
Okay. Cool. Well, it's good to have rich friends, isn't it?
Well, of course, yeah. when it comes to raising money,
because I was like, okay, cool, because that does make a difference. Because if you're just Joe Blogs in the street,
yeah,
not everyone has those friends. That is kind of helpful.
I'm trying to think of who played a major part in it. My best friend Max Keeble White. He exited an investment that he'd made a couple of years prior to that and did okay out of that. And he put in a nice chunk. He was the very first person to invest.
Yeah.
But at the time, I still believe that even my friends were investing in the idea, not so much me. Yeah. I had done absolutely nothing to prove that I was going to get this over the line.
Yeah.
Like, you know what I mean? In fact, you know, they knew me as some pisshead. So I think they must have really liked the brand and the idea, you know, to invest their money in it. You know, there's a lot of my mates who, if I'm being completely candid, if they came to me with a great idea, I'm not sure I'd invest in them. You have to be clear on, you know, a lot of the time you can be presented with a deck which is like incredible and the idea is amazing, and you look at the bloke opposite you and you just go, I just don't think you're going to be able to pull that off. That's a big part of it.
100%. It's 50-50.
So, yeah.
I think it's about 50-50, I'd say.
Yeah.
You invest in the person, which you clearly wouldn't invest in yourself.
Back then, I wouldn't have invested in myself, no.
Yeah.
But I think, you know, part of our early success was surrounding myself with really strong, good people who, you know, essentially when you're starting a business, you aim to eliminate as much risk as possible.
Yeah.
You know, like if you don't know the answer to a question, get the answer.
Yeah.
You know, don't like, guess. Don't go, you know, I'm not sure. It's a toss up between that and that. Oh, I'll just go with that because I feel like, no, find out which is better.
It's more risky. That's what I always say. Risk is only risk if you don't know what you're doing.
Yeah.
It's so true. If you go in
a t-shirt.
No, honestly, I've always said it because people go, oh, you have all these companies. How'd you do it? And I'm like, and isn't it quite risky? I'm like, no, it's zero risk.
Yeah.
Because I've done the research. And
I
already know all the answers. And before even, if there's any risk, I don't do it, you know?
Shooting from the hip is great fun, but eyeing something up properly and doing your DD and understanding it, it is more fun because it's, you know, that it's probably going to go your way. You know, nothing is completely certain or bomb-proof, but like you can certainly make things far more of a certainty by just doing some work on it.
Yeah, 100%. Yeah, shooting from the hip.
Otherwise, we'd just be gambling, you know.
Yeah.
And essentially, you know, these people who have invested heavily into this second round,
yeah,
they would not have done so if this wasn't clear as day to them. Nobody writes a massive check if they, you know, they think there's legitimate reasons why they may not never see their money again.
Yeah.
You know, it's as simple as that, really.
Yeah. Unless they're laundering cash.
Perhaps.
And you're just this horror. You're like the...
I'm the washing machine.
You're the new Steve Madden. Of like the Wolf of Wall Street.
Steve Madden. Oh my God. I love the Wolf of Wall Street so much.
Have you seen that documentary on Steve Madden?
No. Dude, it's amazing.
It's brilliant.
Was he in on it all? Yeah, obviously.
I think, well...
Because in the film... In the film... Oh yeah, because obviously he started shorting his own stock, didn't he?
I don't know. I don't know the ins and outs, but I know he was like... Yeah, I mean... He must have known. I mean, he went to jail, so obviously...
Jordan Belfort on the boat was pretty pissed off when he, you know, in the scene.
I can't remember. I can't remember exactly, but... The documentary...
Leo here is essentially that I think they own Steve Madden together, don't they? They own about 40% of the company in the film. And I think Steve starts, like, shorting his own stock.
Really?
Like, really heavily. But he's obviously got a short position secured against his own company, which is obviously illegal.
Yeah. Sketchy.
That's what it was in the film. I'm sure it's wildly Hollywoodized and inaccurate. But if he's behind bars, then maybe it's not.
So you have another company called Eden Rocks.
Yes, but
compared to Clean Co, is that like a?
It's very different.
I imagine 99% of your time is on Clean, isn't it?
Most of my time is spent on Clean. Yeah, yeah. And actually Eden Rocks is run by an incredible gentleman called Neil Dutson, and that's his life. He also you know, has his own businesses and stuff.
Yeah.
And it was just basically when I was making Vogue's engagement ring.
Yeah,
I was quite surprised by the margins in Diamond Land.
Yeah.
To the point where I couldn't quite believe it.
Yeah.
So I thought that there was definitely a business there.
Yeah.
We were never as aggressive as we could have been with the marketing, you know, just undercutting the competition and just like really, really going for it.
Yeah.
And ultimately my heart isn't really in diamonds or diamond dealing. You know, I love a good deal, like the next person.
Sure,
you know,
sure.
Obviously if I'm able to acquire something and sell it for a lot more, then great.
Yeah.
But ultimately, you know, it's not part of my life. And actually I felt like I was talking about influencers earlier.
Yeah.
I actually felt that whenever I would put something out there about buying a diamond off the posh guy from TV, I was uncomfortable.
Yeah.
Okay. I didn't enjoy the pushing of my very own brand.
Yeah.
It's kind of like, come buy a diamond, which is expensive, off me, so I can be more rich. You know, it's like,
That the ad?
Yeah, that was the ad, yeah.
That's how it felt in your brain.
That I'm sure, obviously, the marketing was nothing like that, but that's what it felt like to me. Yeah. You know, come and meet us and we'll sell you a diamond on the slide. Like, you know, it wasn't quite me. Although I do see very interesting stuff in Diamond Land with all the synthetic stuff and also, I mean, the margins are just, I won't go into it, but they're crazy.
Like, crazy.
Crazy.
But the whole creation of them is, I don't know. You just hear horror stories, don't you? Well, it's like anything.
Yeah.
It's like iPhones.
But like a diamond can come out of a mine, you know, say two of the same diamonds come out of the same mine and one ends up in Cartier and the other ends up in Hatton Garden. They're the same. They're literally the same. And one will cost, you know, $100,000 and one will cost $7,000.
That's the difference for brands, isn't it?
Yeah, exactly. And, you know, of course, I understand paying a premium for a brand, but in your instance with your nice Lamborghini, you know, you can see that it's a, you know, beautiful Lamborghini and, you know, you can kind of touch and feel it. Whereas, you know, when you're buying a diamond and the box inevitably ends up in the bin, you know, what was the point in paying all that additional margin for something that is essentially unbranded?
Yeah, I mean, maybe resale value.
I suppose so, but one would hope that the diamond may last forever. That's the point.
Or your ex-wife will sell it.
Yeah, exactly. And find out that it is valueless. Yes. Well, there we go.
Yeah.
Your ring's not valueless, darling. I hope you keep it.
Did your wife, right?
Yeah.
Did you find the diamond or did you buy a branded one?
No. So that was the very first piece that business made.
Okay.
I met this guy. I was introduced to this guy, Neil, and it was great fun, actually. He's awesome. He's got that love of what he does. Yeah. You know, it's really infectious. He just loves diamonds. His whole life is, you know, just diamonds. Yeah. Diamonds. He knows everything about them.
A diamond dealer.
Yeah, and it's great fun, you know. Yeah. And and essentially, you know, back when we met, it was kind of like, oh, you know, I'll create this ring for you at cost.
Yeah.
You know, if you give us a bit of a push online and blah, blah, blah. Yeah, I was like, classic, super great. So I'd go into Hatton Garden, we'd look through all these stones and like clear security with your passport. And, you know, you'd have all these different stones. And he would tell me the retail value of them and, you know, what he gets them for. And I just, it's right there in the room. I was like, well, let's create a business because I can send people our way and we'll split the upside. But it was only ever him and me and no office or anything. You know, it's just kind of, all upside. Yeah, cost nothing to run.
Yeah.
You know, you get paid for it before you even, you know, pay for the stone. Yeah. So you take the money up front, then pay for the stone. Yeah, like literally zero cost to running the business.
Just a quick flick on social media.
Well, it was wonderful and actually it works really well, but it was kind of, as we did it, it wasn't very scalable.
Yeah.
You know, it's kind of two lads having a fun time, selling stones. Yeah. And actually the demand wasn't there to even consider scaling it. It was great. We'd make, you know, a few rings from time to time, but it wasn't like a kind of, for me anyway, it wasn't like a full time project to sink your teeth into. How do we make this a big global brand? It's kind of like, you know, it's kind
the
of
opposite of clean.
Yeah, exactly. Well, clean, you know, we're looking to, feels like a bomb's gone off.
Yeah, it sounds like it has. I honestly didn't realize until we were talking today.
Right.
I didn't realize how big it was or how much you raised or anything like that.
Good.
Yeah, it's impressive. Thank especially you. In 12 months. Where do you think it'll be in like 5 years?
We aim to be a 100 million plus brand by the end of next year.
End of next year?
Mm. Valuation, not turnover.
I should have invested, shouldn't I?
Not too late, mate. It is actually. We've only just met, you know.
Honestly, I just don't like. Yeah, no. If it, yeah.
It's, I do believe that it's a $1 billion brand.
Yeah.
Not now.
Yeah.
But it will be.
Yeah. What needs to happen?
We need to do significant turnover in the States. We need to kind of erupt and almost grow a category of our own over there. It's very complicated to just have like lift off in America. It very rarely happens. It's incredibly strategic and it's going to take time and effort and a big team and you know, real money and investment behind the brand. And you know, incredibly catchy, fun marketing.
Yeah.
But no, I think, you know, ultimately here we need more distribution. You know, we need to be in more supermarkets, on more shelves. And we need, you know, we'll be doing some influencer and gifting, you know, towards the end of the year. But we're looking to really hit the ground running in January with, you know, there's all sorts kind of going through my mind at the moment where, you know, you see an incredible advert on TV and you love it and it's really exciting and you think it's really fun. But like, how do you get them to go and then buy it? Do you know what I mean? Like when I see a fun advert for Oatly, as I did on the way into this building, I'm not going to stop off at the co-op and buy some Oatly on the way home. So it's kind of like, our fridge is already full of Oatly, to be fair, because of the advert. So it does work, you know, but it's like...
Yeah, well, you've got brand awareness, then you've got, you know, there's lots of different...
Yeah, so there's brand awareness and there's growing the category awareness, and then there's the competitive set, which is going to be, you know, another task that we have for next year. But it's the household penetration piece. It's that piece where, you know, most of the time nowadays, if you're having a lunch party or a dinner party, obviously... Yeah. Oh, we haven't spoken about COVID once. Anyway,
what is that?
Exactly.
I didn't even think about it.
That's, me neither. Yeah. But like my point, if you're having a dinner party or you're having lunch, I guarantee you that there is somebody in your flat or house that that won't drink alcohol.
Yeah.
So like, what do you serve them? So, you know, we want a bottle of clean liquor in every household.
Yeah.
Just as I think, you know, most households in the UK will have a bottle of spirit somewhere, you know, and actually.
Yeah, it makes sense.
Also,
you can do the trick that a friend of mine called James at university used to do, because everyone's poor at uni. And what he used to do, this is no word of a lie, James, he's so funny. if everyone was already drunk and then it was his round, he would just buy everyone lemonades and no one knew. He did this for years, right? And everyone's just like drinking lemonade, thinking that you're getting hammered. It's just Sprite, right? Because he just did a £4 round instead of a 40 quid round.
Yeah.
It was like about four or five years later, I was like drinking a drink with him. And I was like, this just tastes like Sprite. And he went, it is. I went, what are you talking about? He went, well, I only buy people Sprite because no one ever notices that there's no alcohol in it. And I was like, you're a genius. Like, you would have saved me thousands at uni.
Thousands.
Like it is actually genius when you think about it. So like, most people, if you would have given them that at home, they probably wouldn't even notice.
Sometimes when we have people around at the house and it's kind of time to go.
Yeah. You feed them.
I give them clean gin without telling them. And yeah. If people are drinking gin and tonics, I'll just give them. I'll slip in a few. And like, you know, some people can take their alcohol much better than others. Some people become increasingly irritating when they drink alcohol and they kind of lock you into conversations that you really don't want to be having.
Most people.
Exactly. Yeah, and so I often switch in the clean gin. I've never once had anyone notice.
Amazing. You're obviously very charming, you know, very confident, which gets you quite a way through life. There's obviously like a natural competitiveness in you.
Mm.
Where is that from? Is that from your dad?
Possibly. My brother was a professional racing driver. So was my dad. I grew up with two much older brothers. So they were 13 and 14 years older than me.
Oh, really?
So they were always very competitive. So I would watch them kind of, you know, like be competitive with one another. And then one would always take my side and we'd compete against the other one.
Yeah.
And like, I don't know, like...
Because your dad,
you know, at school, for example, I was never like the best at anything, but I've always just had a competitive streak in me. I think it's also just a bit of fun. Like, I find competing with people fun.
Yeah.
I don't think it's, you know, it needn't be unattractive.
Yeah.
Sure. You know, I think if you win, it's nice to be gracious. If you lose, it's nice to not care. Learn. Or, yeah, exactly. Learn.
Someone else.
It's all an experience, isn't it? I think you get some people where it's literally just all about winning, and it's kind of like, I don't know, it's a bit boring.
Yeah,
I don't mind losing as long as I'm losing to someone better.
Yeah,
at that moment.
Yeah,
I got beaten the shit out of by Wayne Bridge. Don't know if you saw it for Sport Relief.
What happened?
That was a humbling experience.
What happened?
We boxed.
Oh, you boxed?
Yeah, we boxed.
Why?
For charity.
Okay, fine.
It certainly felt like it was charitable at the time as well. It's like it was a lot to give.
What happened? You just punched your face in.
Oh, mate, it was awful. Well, okay, so you know those like terrible nightmares that you have where, you know, something just becomes like it just gets worse and worse essentially. So he was supposed to fight Mark Wright, I think, who has a history in boxing, and Wayne Bridge is a boxer now as well. Right, like okay. He's not a boxer, but he's an amateur boxer. Yeah, he's had several fights.
Yeah.
You know, and like I wasn't told any of this, obviously. I get a phone call and it was like, oh, Mark Wright's taking a job or whatever and he can't fight, you know, for Sport Relief. Right. It's 12 million viewers or whatever across the day, and it'd be quite good fun. I was like, oh well, yeah, I'm up for it. Who would I be fighting? I had 6 weeks, by the way. Who would I be fighting? They said Wayne Bridge. I went, oh right, okay. And I'm not a football fan.
But he's obviously fit.
Well, you know, he's an England left back.
Yeah,
plays for his country.
Chelsea player.
Yeah. England and Chelsea. Yeah. So proper kind of animal. I was like, oh, right.
So you're a
professional athlete then.
Yeah, exactly. Confidence kicked in. Exactly. Oh, I could take this guy.
Well, no. So I thought, well, go on then. It's only like it's a bit of boxing, and yeah, go on then. Yeah, fine. How much does he weigh? Oh, he's 79 kilos. I was like 83. I was like, yeah, go on then. Yeah, go, whatever. And I'm training, and they're like, oh yeah, you know, he's a footballer, he's wet, he's a footballer. And I was just like, okay, yeah, fine, no problem. And like, I got to the point where I'm like knocking people down and sparring and stuff, and I'm feeling great about myself as usual. Yeah. And literally, I roll into this thing, and like, I haven't met him ever. He's not 79 kilos, like, at all. He must be 85 kilos. And I had to get down to 80, yeah, for the fight, because we're both supposed to be 80. He's massive. He's a lot bigger than me.
Yeah.
He's taller than me.
Yeah.
I was told he was, like, 5'8". I Googled him, and it said he's, like, little.
Yeah.
He's not fucking little. Google's wrong. Like he's not little. He's about 6'1", 6'2".
Get out.
Mate, I came out. And I came out, walking out, you know, to this music. And there was this screen. Yeah, it is. Oh, yeah. And there was this screen of his training video. And he's like just fucking kicking the shit out of this guy with pads. And I was like, oh, Christ. All right, all right.
Confidence.
Yeah, no, literally. I was like, oh, I feel real shit about this. Anyway, so like, off into the ring. And like, we squared up to each other for the first time.
Oh, God.
And honestly, mate, he's got tattoos from his chin down, all down his arms and all on his legs. Massive, like he's horrible, like looking, piercing, like grey eyes.
He looked dead.
Yeah, and I was like, oh God. We'd opted for no head guards, obviously, because we wanted to be, we were amateur fighters at this stage.
Oh my God.
And yeah.
6 weeks.
Yeah, it wasn't good. The first round was all right. I went back to the corner and I said to my guy, I was like, what the fuck is going on? I was like, he's like, you know, I'm pretty much lost already. And he was like, just go hard in the first round, mate. Fucking go hard. And I was just like, okay. So literally, I just went guns blazing in the first round and had just nothing left. Nothing. I went in the second round, I was a punching bag. And the third round was just embarrassing. Yeah.
Oh my God.
My mum was in the audience. She came to watch because I told her I was going to nail this footballer. Didn't happen. So now whenever I say with huge confidence I'm going to do something, she references it.
She checks your risk
calculator. Yeah. I say to mum, I'm like, mum, like, you know, this business is going to go skies. Yeah, I've heard that before.
Yeah. Mums don't believe anything you say.
Well, especially not after getting the absolute shit kicked out of me by Wayne.
Yeah.
I told her, I was like, mum, like, it'll be done in 30 seconds. Like, don't worry about it. Come up and watch. It'd be great. I hope I don't hurt him too much. That was the kind of vibe. Yeah,
this is a big thing now, boxing, isn't it, on YouTube and all that, and KSI and all these guys.
Yeah, I like,
they make millions out of it.
I don't mind YouTube against YouTube, I suppose. Yeah. But like, all of this Jake Paul Ryan Garcia shit is the stupidest thing I've ever heard. Yeah. Ryan Garcia will knock him out in 5 seconds,
one punch probably,
so quickly it's a joke.
Yeah,
have you seen Ryan Garcia on the pads?
Yeah,
he's like one of the world's best boxers.
Yeah, you have to slow it down.
He's taking on Jake Paul.
Is he actually?
Yeah, apparently.
No.
But it's all just bollocks. I
for money, I guess.
I have my own podcast, by the way. I had Eddie Hearn on
really?
The other night.
He's a dude.
Yeah, he is. And he was just saying, oh, it's fucking ridiculous. He goes, they won't like me saying this, but none of them are fighters. They can't fight. None of them are fighters. And it's true, they're not. You watch their fights, and they kind of, it's like watching me and Wayne. Like, we're not fighters.
It is fun to watch, though. It's just entertainment, right?
No, of course. But I can't get on board with pro boxers fighting YouTubers. That's like me challenging Sebastian Vettel to a race. What's the point? Yeah, I'm quite quick in a car, but he's an F1 racer.
It's a different level. It's like when Conor McGregor fought
Mayweather.
Yeah.
Apart from the fact that Conor McGregor's a fucking animal. Like,
yeah,
Mayweather apparently has a contract to now fight Logan Paul.
Why? No, he said something about 300 million.
No, that's for Khabib million. And that's for Khabib and Conor again.
Okay.
So you fight both of them the same day or something.
Yeah.
He'll kill them both.
Yeah, on the same day.
Easily.
Yeah.
Back to back. No probs.
Yeah.
Like, Floyd Mayweather could go 40 rounds easily. With them. Yeah. Yeah, exactly. And essentially, yeah, apparently Logan Paul is fighting Floyd Mayweather.
Can't be.
May Google it.
Well, Mayweather fought that guy in Japan, was it?
Yeah, but what is all this shit? Why can't they just fight pro boxers?
Because it doesn't sell. That's why.
But why doesn't Floyd Mayweather fight Garcia? There you go.
I don't think they're the same weight.
Are they not?
No, Garcia's quite a bit taller, isn't he? Are you a UFC fan?
I love UFC.
Dude, I've always loved it. I've got Dan Hardy coming on.
Have you?
You know Dan Hardy?
Yes,
British fighter. He used to be a fighter, but he's a more of a pundit now, analyst now.
And what's when was his last fight?
Oh, it was quite a long time ago. It was quite a few years back. But yeah, no, I watched him actually get knocked out at the O2 Arena. This was like over 10 years ago. And weirdly, it was against Carlos Condit, and Carlos Condit just fought this weekend on Fight Island in Dubai or wherever it is, and Dan Hardy was interviewing him after. And there's like a meme, like 10 years on. It's like literally 10 years on when Carlos is still fighting. And 10 years ago, not Dan out. But like, yeah, I'm a big fan of Dan. He was like, he had red hair.
I love all that stuff.
Yeah.
I can't for the life of me understand. So I did jiu-jitsu.
Yeah, same.
Did you?
Yeah, yeah. I did. I haven't done it for about a year, but I did it for a while.
I love jiu-jitsu.
Yeah,
like, it's great. It's like...
It's not great when you get choked, though.
Yeah.
Well, it's not ideal.
Happens.
I immediately tap. I'm like, I'm not even going to try and get at this.
Yeah. How long have you done it?
I did it like for about a year, and then...
Are you blue belt?
No. Well, I would be if I was going properly, but I had private lessons first because I didn't want to go into class and get my ass kicked. Then I went into classes.
Where did you go? Gracie?
Yeah, Gracie in Swindon.
Gracie Baja or Roger Gracie Academy?
No, it's a company is in Swindon. It's called Gracie Swindon.
Oh, right. Okay.
It's a guy called Lucas. He's brilliant. He's one.
I love it. It's like, honestly, it couldn't be a bigger part of my life.
It's amazing. Where did you do it here?
I'm blue belt under Roger Gracie.
Where? Here?
Yeah.
In West London?
So at the moment, I'm training at an academy called Flow, which is under the Gracie banner, essentially just by my office because it's convenient. But I pop into the RGA, Roger Gracie Academy, like for a competition class every so often.
How often do you go?
3 times a week.
Do you?
Yeah.
Yeah, see, literally, I Googled like 2 weeks ago a place around here because I'm not in Wiltshire that much.
I'll come and roll with you.
Yeah, dude, I'll come to your one.
Okay.
Well, I need somewhere closer because
we'll definitely swap now. Like, jiu-jitsu is absolutely key.
It's insane.
Key. Yeah. I use jiu-jitsu terminology in business sometimes. So, like, if somebody says to me...
Oh, don't be that guy.
No, I know. And no one gets it. But like, when people go, oh, we need to, like, get to here. Like, I'll have that as, like, the neck. I was like, mate, you got to get rid of the feet first. You know what I mean? You can't go for the choke.
Are you a Gordon Ryan fan? Are you a Gordon Ryan fan?
Who's Gordon Ryan?
He's like the best jiu-jitsu guy in the world.
What are you talking about, mate? Roger Gracie's the best jiu-jitsu guy.
No, dude. Oh my god, how did you not know that guy? He's like the number one. He beats everyone. Like literally, he's like, it's a joke. He beats everyone, and he's really like, I wouldn't say he's cocky or arrogant. He's not. He's like confident, but he's kind of took it to another level of like notoriety.
What size is he?
I think he's like under, well, he was under 88 kilos when he competed.
Yeah.
But I think he's over that now.
I absolutely love it. It's so key.
He's a beast. He's a beast. He just annihilates
it. What was the other thing? I love
when
that.
When you say, early, just to clarify, right? Yeah. When you say roll with me, right? That's not a gay sort of like, we're going to have sex thing later. Like it's a term that you should probably explain.
Well, rolling is
it means
the martial
like
art
sparring,
of jiu-jitsu. Yeah,
almost like a bit like sparring.
Well, rolling. I actually think it's quite a cool way of describing it. Rolling, like I'm off for a roll.
Yeah,
not a sushi roll.
I mean, it sounds a bit when you go.
Well, and it's
go and
BJJ, you know, BJJ roll,
extra J,
delish. So yeah, no, we'll keep in touch. We'll definitely come over to Flow and we'll have a bust
up. Yeah, we should. Good.
Perfect. There was one more thing I wanted to say, but I can't remember what it is. So perfect.
Go on, think of it. Have a great think about it.
No, I'm all right, mate. Fructose, you know what I mean? I'm really joking. I'm on this savage diet. I'm on a 800 calorie deficit.
Would this be a men's health thing?
Yeah, mate.
Mm-hmm. Have you tried CrossFit?
I saw you on your CrossFit posts. I have tried CrossFit. I actually loved it.
Yeah.
I did my lower back in quite quickly. But one thing I will do is after that, like my base now is quite strong. So for the men's health thing, I've just been doing shitloads of benching, deadlifts, weighted pull-ups and squats is essentially like that's the four big muscle groups that I've been working for like 11 weeks.
Yeah.
So I feel like I'd be better at CrossFit now.
Right.
Because essentially I was just fucking around before and I would kind of hurt my back every time I went to CrossFit because my form would be rubbish.
Yeah.
And being me, I would have to have more on the bar than the person. Like, I'll just do what he's doing.
Confidence. I can lift this.
Yeah. I'll lift anything, mate.
That's how you get injured.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah. You do that in CrossFit though. You get in because you improve so much so quick.
Yeah.
That you start getting a bit confident and then you overload and you injure yourself.
Let's go and do a CrossFit session together and we'll have a roll.
Okay.
Not same day.
No?
Well, I could do.
Do you know, when you do jiu-jitsu, you sweat so much.
It's wonderful.
You? It's so sweaty when you roll.
So sweaty. Yeah. It's really sweaty.
The only thing it's missing is mud.
Yeah. Well, then we'd just be Like Mud pigs and shit. Yeah, exactly.
All right. Well, on that note.
Perfect.
Thanks for coming in. Dude, it's been an absolute pleasure.
Great pleasure.
I've learned a lot. And I think anyone that wants to raise 2 million quid
just with
an
me.
Idea. Yeah. Just Instagram you.
Yeah.
And you'll have the ingredients. No pun intended.
Perfect.
Thanks.
Cheers. Dude. See you later.